This is Mark Hopkins. Welcome back to another episode of Unsung. This week, our guest is going to be Detective David Hanks of the Bucks County DA's office. We're doing it over the phone because he is very busy, and I'll be amazed if he makes it through the whole phone call. And couldn't get him in the studio. We'd like to see him in person. I will get out there and see you in person at some point because it's been a while. But if anybody wants to catch past shows, they're on the web, unsung.us or SoundCloud. And we've gotten a lot of feedback. I got a lot of feedback on one show I did recently, which I'm very thankful for. It somehow got out to people that I haven't talked to in years, and I told a story about one of their loved ones, and they got to hear it, and I didn't even think about the possible repercussions. They were great, and then just been getting a lot of good feedback about shows. And without further ado, Mr. Hanks, and I can't stop calling you Mr. Hanks for some reason. I'm going to try and call you Dave, though, for the duration,
okay,
like
fine.
You asked.
Whatever works for you.
How have you been?
Good, very good.
And I know you're, well, we talked a little bit at the beginning, and I know, and it's been the plight of this show is that I've always tried to get unsung and underspoken people, and you're kind of the king of underspoken and unsung, and they're who I've tried to get on the show because I find that they have the most compelling backstories to drive people to see the value of doing these various careers. How did you get started in law enforcement?
Well, basically, I was born in the UK, and I don't think I had any thoughts from the beginning for a career path. It was going to be going into the military, then when I leave the military, joining the police. And most police departments in Britain, back then, even more so now, a large county or departments, very large departments. I think the Metropolitan Police may be bigger than New York City Police, maybe 40,000 people. But what happened in the interim, once I left the Army, I spent some time traveling around Europe and the Middle East, and I ended up meeting an American, and we got married in England and came back to the United States. It was very difficult applying for a job, a law enforcement job, in one continent when you're living on another continent. It's
to commute alone.
Impossible. Yeah, it was. I'm talking. Also, I'm talking about the mid '80s, so everything was done by mail. So just the process was months and months and months, and included a visit back to England. And after a while, we just decided it was far too complicated. By then, we'd had a couple of children, and we were staying here forever. So after that point, obviously, everywhere apart from the Pennsylvania State Police, you needed to be a U.S. citizen. I don't know whether that's changed now, whether you need to be a U.S. citizen to be a member of the state police, but back then you didn't. I started applying for police jobs and then realized I believe I got on the state police list, but I was I can't even remember. It was the hundreds. I was in the hundreds. So eventually I waited for the 6 years till I became a U.S. citizen. And then I started applying for police department jobs.
Where did you start out at?
I started taking tests for the federal government, and I got interviewed for the marshals. And at the same time, I was taking tests for municipal police departments. I got hired by Falls Township. And then immediately after I got hired by Falls Township, the U.S. Marshals called up and said on a Friday and said, we want you down in Georgia on the Monday. So I think just by that last minute call from the Marshals, I decided I'll stay with Falls Township. So I stayed with Falls Township from 1989 to 2008 for 19 years.
It's amazing how just that little bit of timing, if that were different, your whole life might be different.
Yes. Yeah. I think if the marshals had said, be down there in 2 weeks, I probably would have been down in Georgia, and then I'd probably be out somewhere in Wyoming and would have never been in this area. But I think I made the right choice. I made the right choice for the township. So a good department to work for. And it's a fairly busy department, obviously nowhere near as busy as the city of Philadelphia. But it's a well-run and busy department.
Well, you definitely made the right choice for the for Falls Township and for the Bucks County DA's office where you are currently. Yeah. When I met you, I believe we first met at Dempster, the Dempster Fire Academy. Is that where you first met?
Yeah, during Sea Cadets.
Yeah.
That must have been. I was trying to figure out the years when I was involved in Sea Cadets.
Probably, do that. It'll just get us upset.
It was before 9/11, but maybe the year 2000 to about the year 2007.
People born that year are voting now or something. So, mm-hmm. It's been that long. I remember you even in that you stood out because you're very conscientious and. You're very conscientious, and you work well with the kids, and really enjoyed working with the kids. The women loved your accent. They loved you. I've never told you that, but they loved your accent.
It comes in useful sometimes.
I think that a British accent is like the best unsung tool. We have a woman on the team that has a British accent, and I stick her with making a lot of the phone calls because I think she can get away with saying things that aren't as harsh with the accent. And we do that a lot with her. How long did you do the Sea Cadets for?
It's for boys boys and girls, age 13 to 17. So my son left when he was 18, and we started before 9/11. So for about 7 or 8 years.
Okay.
And probably after about the second year, we started to get involved in the search and rescue. And I believe, actually, that we probably saw one of your displays at one of the air shows.
Okay, yeah.
Maybe it's
Willow Grove.
Willow Grove Air Show, when they still had an air show there.
That's right.
And we had the cadets working with the parking and various other duties and just to be there to look around. But we saw it there, and then we came to one of your meetings in Abington, and then we tried to adopt, I don't know whether it's still around, the CERT.
Yes.
The Community Emergency Response Team. We started to adopt, we just stole some of their manuals and started to do our own thing. Then we reached out to you. And I think for a while there, we had a lot of interest in it. But I think after I left, obviously, if there's no one to guide it towards that type of activity, then it's going to disappear.
Yeah, you became kind of the guiding force in that, and it's always, there's always a lot of people that are doing a lot of things that make it happen, but there's always a core group, and sometimes that core could be one person, and mm-hmm. it seemed to be you. Did you ever do any law enforcement in Great Britain?
No, I didn't. I was in the military. I was in the military for 6 years. I was a aircraft technician, kind of like a crew chief.
Okay.
For first line maintenance I was trained as typical with any type of military. I spent 3 years training on helicopters, and then they posted me to the only six fixed wing aircraft the British Army had. That's typical. You learn again.
Yeah.
But first line maintenance, just pre-flight checks and oil changes and getting the aircraft ready and loading them up and going on little sorties and that kind of stuff. It was fun.
Who mentored you when you got started over here in law enforcement?
I don't know whether I had any one mentor. In Falls Township, we had a couple of sergeants who are both direct supervisors, and I fell under their wings for several years. I still speak to them both. One of them became a chief of Marsfall. One's now the chief of Falls. I still speak to them. So if anybody mentored them, it would be those two, and possibly even when I started to work undercover narcotics, possibly even my present chief now, who's with the Attorney General's office at that time. So perhaps between those three people, I could say I had, you know, three mentors throughout my law enforcement career.
Okay. What do you think makes you good at the job?
It depends what part of the job. I mean, there's so many different parts of the job. It's probably the same in any job. Listening is probably the biggest thing. You have to listen to people. In law enforcement, if you're working the street, you may be meeting people who are just having their first contact with law enforcement and don't know how to act, or they may be having the worst day of their life. You very seldom meet people at the best of times. And my job now, you know, being a detective for the last, I got to figure out how long that's been, for the last 17, 18 years, my biggest, you know, once again, it's listening to people, treating people with dignity, letting them speak. And I think being a detective, just having a work ethic. You have to keep going. You can't stop. The old wear out the shoe leather type of thing, you know, knocking on doors. Although in this day and age, the doors we're knocking on are more often digital doors than wooden front doors. But you have to have a certain amount of you have to be a self-starter. You can't have people telling you what to do. You have to know what you want to do, and you just keep going for it until you finish one job and go to the next.
Well, that leads me to my next question. How has technology changed your job over the 17, 18, 19 years? Dramatically?
I mean, technology as a detective, dramatically. Technology as a law enforcement officer, dramatically, too. And going to general law enforcement, from 1989 to today, 1989, there's 35 millimeters. There's no digital cameras. People refused to use digital photographs for a long time because they could be altered. Not that anybody actually has the technology to alter them. Now I can get far better crime scene photographs on my iPhone than I could with any 35 millimeter camera. One of the other things, 20 years ago, probably even 15 years ago, when a police officer messes up or says something wrong in public, nobody knew about it, just the people involved. Now a police officer says something or does something, it's on YouTube within a couple of minutes. So there's no getting away from that. Various other things that have changed. I mean, armament, people used to carry shotguns, they switched over to rifles. Car chases are non-existent anymore. Active shooter responses have changed from, you know, after Columbine, from waiting outside to going in. Everything as simple as the tickets. The tickets are not handwritten anymore. They're printed out. Video evidence, which in my opinion is fantastic. Everyone should be wearing cameras because it protects people more than puts them in bad situations. And